And welcome to Sharon Mennonite Church. It's really good to see you here. I know this is a busy time for traveling, so it's great to see everyone this morning. I have a couple of announcements to make, and then if anybody has any others, just raise your hand and they'll bring a microphone to you. First is the reading program participants can meet me in the library after church. If you read 20 minutes a day, 5 times a week in June, I have a prize for you, so any age. You're good. The second announcement is the youth group is going to do the youth fellowship luncheon today. So meet out in the lobby after church and you guys can pick where you want to eat. So now, any other announcements?
All right, good morning. I have a long list, so listen up. Communion, we are going to have communion next Sunday, so be prepared for that. There's also going to be a love offering for Jenny next week. And also, because I'm so nice and Dennis isn't here, I'm going to extend you grace. So your nomination ballots that you haven't gotten in yet, you got one more week.
Yes.
So to all you procrastinators, quit procrastinating like me. Last but not least, next Sunday, we are going to have a discussion period during Sunday school. The plan is the youth have the youth breakfast starting at 9, so we want to get started shortly thereafter. There's a few things that we want to talk about. One is an interim associate pastor, which you all should have letters in your mailbox. So we want to have a discussion period around that. The search committee is also going to give an update, and also we hope to have time to be able to talk about a little bit about the structure review as well. So that'll be next Sunday. So if you have any questions, talk to one of the elders. Don't call me. I'm going to Germany tomorrow, so you may not want to hear from me when I call you back. So that's all I have.
Thanks, Mark. Any other announcements? We'll go ahead and say our Bible memory verse for today. So is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. Isaiah 55:11. Thank you. Good news. What are some examples of good news that we are excited to share with others? We all probably have personal ones. I'm going to share a couple of others. Some are really significant, like engagements, pregnancies, graduations, job offers. Most significant, accepting Christ as your Savior. That's a huge deal. It's the most important thing. Some aren't so significant. I had the best cappuccino here. I was able to buy 100-pack of paper towels here, and it was buy one, get one free. This place makes the best burgers. You know, good news, it varies. I know I'm always excited to share about books I've read or results of some research that's been released, my favorite libraries, my flowers making it through the cold winter and coming back up and blooming. I love that. And amazing people who are kind. This past weekend, we went up to Northeast Ohio, and we went to Youngstown State to visit, just to give the girls an idea of where we went to school. And one of the professors were there, and she came and she talked to them and took time. She was on her way out the door at 4:30 on a Friday afternoon, and she just came up to us and was asking. You know, she was like walking to the parking garage. She did not need to talk to us. And we found out she was the dean, actually. It was really neat. But she came and asked a bunch of questions and took time. And she had a lot of energy and love for what she did. And you could feel that, and we appreciated that. It was really neat. We also had the boys in a coin shop the next day. And this really great guy took all this time to tell the boys about how great it is to collect coins and how the business works now and all the internet stuff that goes with it. But he was teaching them how to start a collection if they wanted to, and giving them advice. And he had such energy and love for what he did, and you could just pick up on that. And it was a really neat experience that we had two different people that took time for all four of our kids over a couple of days that were complete strangers, but really neat people. We loved his energy. In Romans 1:15, Paul speaks about being eager to preach the gospel. In 2 Timothy 3, Paul tells Timothy, the Holy Scriptures are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All scripture is God-breathed. And Jesus himself says in Matthew 28:19, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. It's great to share good news, but it's the best news that we can share is that Christ died for you and for me, and if we confess our sins and ask him to live in us, we'll live with him for eternity. I really appreciate this quote from Anne Bess Gump. She says, believers are not citizens of earth trying to earn our way to heaven. Rather, we are already citizens of heaven making our way through our life here on earth. And that's amazing news and comfort to me. Let's bow our heads to pray, please. Father God, we thank you for this beautiful morning. We thank you for the freedom that we have to gather and worship in your holy name. Amen. Cliff is going to now come and lead us in music.
If you would, in your Mennonite hymnal, reddish brown book, the Mennonite hymnal, turn to number 4. Number 4 in the Mennonite hymnal. When you find that, those of you who wish to, would you stand to as we sing together? Turn now to number 104. In the Mennonite hymnal, turn to number 104.
Thank you.
so excited that Tony is here from the Gideons to speak with us today. I remember receiving a Gideon's Bible in the mid-90s. They had all their boxes out on the sidewalk in front of our high school, and that's where you could go and get them. And in the late 90s, on campus, they let the Gideons set up boxes on the, there was a bridge, a covered bridge that went an overpass into the university from the parking garage. So I remember my specific places where I've received them. I'm grateful for what you do. I really am. We're excited to hear what you have to say today. There will be two offerings today. The first is for the general fund here at Sharon. The second one is a love offering for the Gideons, and that will be second. So if you can just bow your heads with me and we'll pray. Lord, I thank you for blessing us so richly. Please guide and direct us to use our gifts to honor you and bring glory to your name. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
In the Mennonite hymnal, turn to number 67. Number 67 in the Mennonite hymnal.
Scripture for today is the same as our Bible memory verse. So is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. Isaiah 55:11. Tony, welcome.
Brought a lot of goodies with me, so I'll get to show them to you. Good morning. Let me start you off with a little bit of a story. There was a young man. He attended the University of Delhi. From India, And if you know anything about India, it is mostly a Hindu country. But there is a state in southern India that is mostly Christian. So this man was brought up in a very prosperous family, Christian home. But around 17 years old, just despair took over his heart. And he didn't understand the conflict that he was feeling inside of him. He knew what he was hearing through the messages that he heard, but he didn't understand what that meant in his life. So, like I said, he was a student at the University of Delhi, very intelligent, very bright young man. He decided he would bring home some chemicals from the chemistry lab in which he was working. And he took those chemicals, mixed them in a glass of water, and in despair, drank them down. Now you have to understand the culture of India. It was a very wealthy family. They had servants. A servant came and found him on the floor. And but for that servant finding him on the floor and getting the medical attention that he needed, getting him to a hospital so that he could be saved, we would have lost one of the most prominent apologists that the world knows today. His name is Ravi Zacharias. And because of his despair, he tried to commit suicide. But while he was in the hospital, he had an encounter with the Word of God because he found a Bible in his room. Let me get the right one here because I've got a bunch. So he had an encounter with the Word of God in his room. And when he read it, just like for many people, when they read the Word of God, it will change their life, and it changed his life. And if anybody knows about Ravi Zacharias, he has a ministry now called RZIM out of Atlanta, Georgia. And if you've never, if any of you YouTube this man, he is brilliant. He is the most brilliant apologist, one of the most brilliant apologists that we have today in the world. Like I said, he was in such despair that he tried to take his own life. But through the Word of God that he found in his room in the hospital where he was saved, not only was his life saved, but his soul was saved. And now today, we have this wonderful man who comes around the world so that other people can come to know that same knowledge of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Amen. My name is Tony Rizzini. I'm part of this ministry called the Gideons International. It is an association of Christian businessmen and their wives, which we call the Auxiliary. And what are we all about? We're about getting the Word of God in people's hands. That's what we do. We share our testimonies. We provide Bibles. This is what we do. A body of believers, we are in approximately 200 countries around the world. In the world, there are about 205 to 207 political entities in the world right now today. The Bible has been preached in about 200 or maybe a few more of them. There are still a few countries out there that don't have the Word of God. But the Gideons, along with other people, the Bible League, several other, getting the Word of God in so that it can fulfill when Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the good news. We haven't hit the whole world yet, but we're trying. We still have a few countries out there that are very, very challenging for us. As you can imagine, North Korea is not real receptive to the gospel, and there are several other countries that are not acceptable to the gospel. But we are right now in, we have distributed 85 million Bibles across the world, and we actually do this in 95 different languages. So we also partner with people who can help us translate the word into the language of the local peoples. So a little bit of history about the Gideons. How did we come together? Two men, one's name is John Nicholson. This was in about 1898. They were at a conference together in a town in Wisconsin called Boscobel, Wisconsin. Very crowded that night, and John, being the man he was, being a Christian man, he had a double room, and he offered his other bed to somebody else. And this gentleman by the name of Samuel Hill took that offer, and they were together. And after talking with each other, they realized they were both believers in Jesus Christ. So they had a wonderful time sharing together and had their devotions together, and they prayed. And they both felt called that there needed to be a ministry to get God's word into people's hands. So in 1899, May 31st of 1899, they actually formed what we call the Gideons today. And their first meeting was in Janesville, Wisconsin, and it was actually in a YMCA. So these two men, John Nicholson and Samuel Hill, are responsible for the launch of this ministry. So it's been around for quite a while. We've distributed, where do we distribute? Well, mostly what you do is you go to a hotel and you see Bibles. Everybody see Bibles in the hotel? Oftentimes they're blue, they may be brown like this one. A couple other colors we might have as well. You might see this gold one as well. So let me tell you some stories about some of the challenges per se that we have and some of the successes, because God is behind this. You go into most hotels today and you can find a Bible. Some you can't. A lot of hotels are franchised, and the general management of that franchise decides, can the word be placed there or can it not? So we do have hotels that say, no, we're not going to place the word there. I need to tell you about a recent success. With a camp of men, we go around, once a month or so, we go out to different hotels to check. We call them, do you need any new Bibles? Because if people take these, this is wonderful. Because when you open this up, all kinds of things are categorized so that if you're in a time of need, we want people to look at this book. We want people to take this book, and we want to have to go and replace them. Well, there was a particular hotel here in the Columbus area where the management at that point said, nope, we are not going to do that. We are not going to put Bibles in there. And we've seen that. But this particular hotel went through a change in their ownership and their management, and a man called us and said, we need Bibles. And usually when we go out, we bring cases of the Bibles, and we'll go somewhere and, hey, we need 10, we need 20, whatever. This hotel called, got in touch with some of my Gideon brothers and said, hey, we need 10 cases of Bibles. So you know what they did. They showed up there, and they gave them 10 cases of Bibles because they want to make sure that this is in everywhere we can. So the Gideons, you should find this. And if you're ever in a hotel and you don't see it there, please ask the front desk if they could possibly do that, because that could possibly spur the management to think, we should have the Word of God in these hotels because our patrons are asking for it. So please do that. So we have our testaments that way. We go into hotels. That's our big one. We also go into hospitals and nursing homes. Like I said, Ravi Zacharias, because that testament was in that hospital which he was in, that saved his life. We also go into medical offices and into domestic violence centers. So we have different types of urges, and I'll talk about those shortly. We go into prisons and schools and universities, which we already heard about. Now, you wonder, why did this guy come with all these different Bibles? Well, we print all kinds of things. This is a soft cover version of the Bible. This is the full version. We take these into prisons. We can't have a hardback version in a prison, as you can understand. A lot of prison work, a lot of prison ministry happens because of the Gideons. And men can be very creative about what can become a weapon. And a hardcover book could become a weapon. So we always bring in the soft covers into the prisons. This is an example of what we bring. And again, these are always free. We never ask anyone to pay for anything, because we are all about the Word and to bring those things in. And then I've got my color code chart, because I've got a whole lot of things I want to show you here. Grab these out. We take these things called PWTs, Personal Witness Testaments. These are the small ones. And if you're at the school, you probably received a PWT, a Personal Witness Testament. And why do we call them that? Because in the back of the PWT is a very simple plan of God's salvation right there. When we hand these out, I always tell people, you know, we make it really hard. You know, we have to do this and do this and do this and do this. It's really simple, right? Romans 3:23. Who knows the Roman road, right? 3:23, all of sin fallen short of the glory of God. Right? 6:23, the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And Romans 5:8, let me get that one in there. I knew I was going to. Romans 5:8, it's not coming to me. But we go through this, and we show people it's really, really, really simple, right? And we explain them. So we've got all these different testaments. We've got all these different colors and types. So let me explain these to you and what they all mean. And there is a reason why we have all these different colors. All right. So these orange testaments, these we use for sidewalk distributions when we go to the universities. Ohio State University is probably the biggest one that we do. Each year, we distribute about 10,000 of these testaments to the students at Ohio State. And a few stories about this. Do I ever have anybody who tells me no? I do. Do I ever have anybody who tells me they're an atheist? Yes. But most people are pretty accepting. And I'll tell you a story about a young man. His name was Josh. And Josh and I had just a discussion about what this was all about, and we opened this up and we started talking about God's plan of salvation. And this was back in probably 2015 or so when I met this young man, and I gave him the testament. And as he walked away, he looked at this, because this is the words of eternal life. And I watched him and I said, God, change this young man's heart. Change his heart. I still pray for him. I have no idea whatever happened to him. I'm sure he's graduated and gone and probably working by now. I still pray for Josh every day, right? Because I knew God was using me to speak to that young man through this personal witness testament that we were handing out at that university. So we have these. We also go into, I'm looking at my chart here. So we also have green ones too that we use for those. We have I didn't get it out here. We have a version, you're going to appreciate this when I show it to you, because you'll know exactly what it is. Camouflage version, right? We get to go into the military installment, and these guys are hungry, right? They know that they're going to be stepping into potentially a very, very dangerous situation. They're very appreciative of this. So we have different versions. This is actually for like a desert. We have a green camo, we have a blue camo, right? So we have all kinds of different versions that we'll hand out to our military young men and women as they go and get ready to serve. We have a white version, which we go into and hand out to medical professionals. We use this. We have this periwinkle version, which is a light blue version. The wives of Gideons are called the auxiliary. And so this is the periwinkle version. And I talked about the pregnancy decision centers and so forth. They'll go into those places and distribute those. You know, we get people in a time of crisis, because that's often when they're open most to the gospel. Right? They're in a time of crisis, and they don't know where to turn. They have a burden on their heart. This has the answer. This is all the answers that are in this book. They really, really are. And the more and more I read this book, and the more and more I talk to people, this is the answer. The answer to all the world's problems is in here. It truly is. So we have all these different versions of the personal witness testaments that we hand out. And we talked about that Isaiah 55:11, that's a Gideon verse, right? So shall my word go, so shall my word be that it goes from my mouth. It will not be to return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please. It shall prosper for which I have sent it. Let me tell you a story about recently what happened to me. I also, on the side, I do a little Ubering. Everybody ever taken an Uber? Right? I do that a little bit on the side, just for a little bit of extra money. And I had a woman get in the car, and she had a backpack, and I noticed she had a headscarf on. And so when we got in the car, I helped her put her backpack in, and her name was Diane. And I started talking to Diane, and we were going to the airport. And I said, well, Diane, what's going on? She said, well, I've had 46 rounds of chemo. I was diagnosed with bone cancer in 2013, and the doctor basically said, we're not going to do anymore. It's not helping. So she was here visiting her son, because she's going around to see her children just to have that personal goodbye with them. And so I'm talking to Diane, taking her to the airport. And I got to a point and I asked her, I said, Diane, what do you think's going to happen when you die? I said, well, I hope I'm going to heaven. I said, well, there is a way to know for sure. And I talked to her, and I carry some personal witness testimonies with me. And I talked to her and I said, Diane, it's right here. And I talked to her about God's plan of salvation, how we have to recognize that we are sinners. We have to repent of our sin, and we have to receive this free gift of grace that he offers us. It's very, like I said, we make it difficult. It's really very simple. You have to recognize the state that you're in, you have to repent, and you have to receive God's gift of grace. And so when we got to the airport, ending this conversation, she got out, of course I got out to get her stuff, and tears were coming down her eyes. And I handed her this. I said, take some time, read this. Know that you're a child of God and that he loves you and that he wants you to be with him. How many people do you know can see in the future, it's like, I've only got a year or so left. Right? Most of us don't have that kind of clarity into our life. But when we do, we want to make sure that we tell someone that there is a plan, and that plan is in God's word. We want to get the, and that's what the Gideons do. They want to get God's word into people's hands so that they can see that they are loved and that they can be forgiven, because salvation came through Jesus and his shed blood on the cross. And we just explained that to him. It was a very, very powerful encounter. And I've also added Diane to my prayer list. Diane from Denver. I'll be praying for her for at least the next year or so. I don't know when God will call her home, but she knows it's going to be soon. But I also know that he can take that little testament that she got and change her heart so that she can come to know that there is salvation and there is peace in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Another big thing that we do is we go to the prisons. Talked about that earlier. We go into the prisons. There is this place in the Columbus area. It's called the CRC. If you ever go south on 71, I know it well, so it's exit 94. It's called the CRC. It's called the Central Relocation Center. And this is for men. And any man in the state of Ohio who is convicted and is going to be imprisoned in a Ohio penitentiary will initially go to what's called the CRC until there is a location for him. At London, at Madison, at, you know, there's several institutions. I think there's 14 institutions that are around the state of Ohio. So we go there, and not only our camp, I'm from what's called the Northwest Camp. We have four camps in the state, in the city of Columbus, and we alternate. We go on Mondays and Wednesdays, and we go and we talk to the men, and we bring them the gospel message. Had some incredible opportunities to share, because I kind of look at it this way. When we're there sharing with these men, they're kind of at rock bottom, right? They're institutionalized. They're going to go to a prison for a certain amount of time. What an opportunity to share with them that, yes, you might have to pay your penalty for whatever crime you did, but you do not have to pay the penalty of your sin, because it was paid for you by Jesus on the cross. And so we talk to these men, we pray with these men, and we have these great opportunities. We do a smaller group. This sort of rotates. It happens typically on Mondays. We do a smaller group and a larger group. And we offer the gospel to these men. We offer the gospel and we say, if anybody is here who needs to know Jesus' salvation, you have to recognize that you're a sinner. You have to repent of your sin and you have to receive his grace. And we've had many, many men there at that institution accept this offer. Like I said, they're kind of on their last leg. They're staring down, some of them, many years in an institution. And I told them, I was just there last week, Monday, talking to this man. I said, you don't have to live in prison to the sin for the rest of your life. You can be free from that. Right? Take this burden off of you. Jesus came to take this burden off of you, and he does it. Now, the interesting thing about the prison, we used to be able to take in the PWTs to the prisons. Unfortunately, we can no longer do that. Just the way the things work in the state, things are becoming more and more challenging. But we are able to deliver cases of the soft copy of the Bibles. So we take those have to go through their process. They have to take them in and make sure that there's nothing inside of here, right? So they take a look at all this, but we are able to do this and provide them the soft cover Bibles. So that's what we do for the institutions, for the gentlemen inside. You know, it talks about in Mark 16:15, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Now, it's taken about 93 years, started in 1899. Actually, the formation, the actual, came together in 1908. From 1908 to 2001, it took that long for the Gideons to distribute their first 1 billion copies of the scriptures. That next 1 billion took about 15 years. So from about 2002 to 2014-15, we were able to distribute another 1 billion copies of God's Word. So 2 copies of God's Word are distributed about every second around the world. There is a Gideon doing something. And over 1 million Bibles and New Testaments are distributed about every 4 days. So this is not only happening here in the States, this is happening all over the world. Men are doing this. So we ask you to please pray for those who are receiving these testaments so that they will read them, they will open up the book, and they will realize that there is a God out there who loves them, particularly in many of the countries where you're not able to share the gospel. It's very dangerous, too. There was a story of a Gideon who was in a country where it was very dangerous for them to be sharing the gospel, and he got himself in a little bit of hot water, and he did have a Gideon testament tucked into his pocket. It was either gunfire or something happened, but whatever it was, because he had this here, it actually hit this and stopped it. And when he got back, and he said he was in a very dangerous situation, they weren't sure they were going to live through it. But when he got back, he noticed he had this hole, and he opened it up, and sure enough, the Word of God had stopped that bullet from penetrating, and that would have taken him out in his heart. So it is very dangerous where we have to go sometimes. There are other things that we do. Another big thing that we have is called the Gideon Card Program. Let me show you an example of that. So Gideon cards, we have these cards that are meant to be used, and when somebody, in memorial, when somebody passes away, when someone is sick, you can actually send them a card, and inside that card you can make a donation for a certain number of Bibles that will be donated to the Gideons. So I don't know if we have a Gideon card display here, but we can get one set up for you. And it's a great way to, particularly a memorial to someone, is to, we're not going to actually donate to any particular charity, but we're going to send you a card, and the money that you include will go towards a Bible. It costs about $10 to print one of the bigger Bibles. These smaller Bibles, these PWTs, cost just under $2 for us to print these, and are actually one place in Nashville, Tennessee. The Gideons are based out of Nashville, Tennessee, and there's one printer that we have that does all of these things for us. So we have the Gideon Card Program. That's something else that we have, and we also have something called, I've got it in here, it's called the Life Book. And the Life Book is for youth ministries, and it talks about God's love and God's plan for them. And again, these are available free to anybody who is a youth minister, that you can get this. It's called the Life Book, and you can use this with your youth group. It takes them through God's plan of salvation. And again, there's never a cost for any of these things. We distribute these things free everywhere. That's what we do. I know that we just took up a collection for the Gideons, and I'll tell you that your money will go to print these scriptures. Every time we have any kind of a Gideon event, they're talking about printing scriptures, getting them into people's hands. We don't talk a lot about the administrative side. Yes, we have a president, an international president in Nashville, and there is a staff in Nashville, but that's never the focus. We never talk about expanding the staff or enhancing it. We talk about getting monies to print scriptures, because that's what the Gideons were founded on, those two men back in Wisconsin, when when they got together, they realized that we need to get the scriptures into this, into the people's hands, because, you know, it talks about this. It says, Hebrews 4:12, that the word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and joints and marrow, and is discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So that scripture, just getting the word of God in people's hands, changes them, right? You recognize who you are. All of us can know that we are sinners. I know I am, right? When I was a child, I was in fifth grade, we used to be able to do this. We used to be able to go into schools and distribute scriptures. We used to have red scriptures that we took in. Just grab one of these scriptures. But we had some men who came into my fifth grade class, so I was almost 10 years old, and they actually gave all of us one of these scriptures. We're not allowed to do that anymore. We can't go into the schools. A lot of the legal aspects of the word and, you know, the whole idea of separation of church and state, that's, you know, that's prevented us from doing many things. But the high school distributions, when we go do that, we can do that. We just have to make sure we're on a public sidewalk, right? So we used to be able to go into the schools, distribute the word of God directly in the classrooms. Now we have to do it on the outsides of the schools. When we do this, particularly at the high schools and some of the middle schools, we have to be on public sidewalks. Anytime we do that, we also have to have these legal documents that say we have permission to be there. Because I've been confronted one time by somebody who was not very happy that I was there. But, you know, like I said, the word of God is powerful, and people, it convicts people. And when we're there, I've had a few people say some things to me that weren't very kind, but I just know that the word of God was touching their heart. Otherwise, they wouldn't react that way, right? If they didn't feel whatever that is about the word of God touching them, they wouldn't come and react that way. So I just pray for them. I've had another one of my Gideon brothers, had a little more of a direct encounter. Somebody took a milkshake, threw it straight in his face. Right in his face, covered him all over, wiped himself off, cleaned himself up, and just kept going. Because we're not there to confront people. We're just there to tell them about the word of God. So in Proverbs 22, just I'm going to close with this. In Proverbs 22:6, it says, train up the child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. That's my Gideon story. I still have my little testament that was given to me by those men in fifth grade. I was going to grab it, but I still have it. And I wrote in it, I will keep this all my life. And God's been faithful. And I can think, I didn't always walk with the Lord, I'll tell you that much. During my college years, I walked away from the Lord, and I did things my way, because I thought my way was going to work good, all right? And it wasn't until when I met my wife and I started to go back to church again, and I saw this pastor start talking, and I thought, okay, there's something here that I'm missing. But I'd always save that little Bible, that little red Bible, because I said, I will keep this my whole life, and I will. I still have that. Because when we train up a child in the way he or she should go, they will not depart from it. And so that's what we are doing in the Gideons. We are out in the world bringing the scriptures, particularly to people in crisis, whether that would be in a hotel. We hear all the times about stories where people are in hotels in a desperate situation. They reach for a drawer, they open up, and they find the Gideon's Bible, and they look, and they see God's plan of salvation, that he actually loves them. Or possibly a personal witness testament, and they read through that, they take that home. Just like I told you about that young man, Josh. As Josh walked away, he was reading about the fact that God loves me, that I'm a sinner, that there is a remedy for my sin, and I need to be saved. I can still see that young man, Josh, in my head walking away. So know that the money that you give to the Gideons is going towards the purpose of getting the word of God into people's hands so that they can come to know salvation that comes through Jesus Christ. So at the end, if you would like to talk to me at all, at the end of the service, I'm going to be in the back with Pastor Vicki, and I'd love to meet you, love to talk with you. If you have any questions about the Gideons, let me know, and we'll talk to you about it. Thank you.
life song book, turn to number 244. Number 244. Do you feel like standing? I thought so. 244. Singing the doxology then for the benedictory song.
We will now Lord, take our minds and think through them. Take our lips and speak through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire for you. Amen.